Hello everyone, so I am Pratamesh Saunke from FOSSI project team. So there are various projects in FOSSI that you can take up for internship. So I will be presenting three of them, alright. So these are the list of projects. So I will be presenting first three projects. So the first project is build IPython widgets backend. So there is a trades UI package in Python. Using that you can build user interface very easily, means in few lines of code you can build a beautiful UI. So for example, like this, within 8 to 10 lines of code and you can build an UI. So similar thing we want to build in IPython. So IPython, there are IPython widgets. Using widgets you can build user interface in IPython notebook. So basic aim is to build an initial version of IPython widgets backend. So this will allow users to easily display UI on remote IPython notebook. So for this, you should know Python, IPython, IPython widgets, and JavaScript. Qt is optional. So Qt, WXPython is the backend used by the trades UI package. So the next project is automation of certificate generator. So FOSSI team organizes various events, conferences, workshops, alright. So we need to provide certificates to the participants, speakers, and coordinators. So this process should be very simple and automated. So for that, okay, and as an organizer, you will simply feed in the event details, the participant details. And then using an interface, I can simply create a certificate template, which will be a simple drag and drop. Alright. So, and then on one click, I can send the certificates to the participants via mail. Okay, that easy the process should be. And the system, that is your application, should, okay, keep the authenticity of the certificate so that it should generate QR code. Okay, for each certificate, the QR code will be unique. Okay, so and using QR code, you can verify the certificate. And obviously, validation of email IDs. And as a participant, you can verify the certificates, give feedback about the events and certificates. So technologies required will be Python Django, LaTeX for creating certificate, or any other package, Django package, that is Report Lab, or any other package you can use. Then you should have knowledge of HTML, JS, CSS, and some knowledge of Git. The third project is revive Python Flew package. So Python Flew is a Python module, okay, which you can use to interact with OpenFOAM. OpenFOAM is a computational fluid, okay, dynamics software. So using Python Flew, you can interface with OpenFOAM. All right, so the problem is that Python Flew supports the older versions of OpenFOAM. So we need to revive this package and support the latest version of OpenFOAM. So for this, you should have very good knowledge of C++, okay, Python, and some knowledge of Swig. Alright. So, yeah, and the important gain for this project is that you will interact with Professor Prabhu Ramachandran. Alright. So, because he's the mentor of this project. Alright. Yeah. So, all the best. Thank you.
So, hello everyone. I'm Priyanka. I'm a software engineer at FOSSI project here. So, our basic aim is to create websites for the project. Basically, this internship, we are asking you guys to help us out with website development for Scilab project. So we have a website called scilab.in. So it is already developed. We are here to enhance the features of the website. So there is a activity in FOSSI, which is book companion project. So in this, suppose you have a book that gets converted into Scilab code and that gets uploaded. So this entire interface is created in that website. So our basic aim here is to ease the process and enhance its feature for user and reviewer interface. So the things that you'll achieve in this particular internship over this project is that the TBC user interface, you will need to enhance the already existing book proposal interface. So for example, how users can upload, how they'll download, then how the books can be saved, and other such enhancements. Second is the code upload. So currently what happens is the book gets saved on the server and the entry gets to the database. So we would like that there is a standard way how the codes get uploaded, and also it automatically gets pushed to the Git repo. So the knowledge of Git would be required for this. Third is that you know, right, there can be scripts which you run and it automatically tells that these are the errors found or some sort of code. So we would like to write a script which will scan all the codes and tell us if there are any dependencies issues or any other problems which are there in the code at the time of submission. Second phase is the TBC review interface. So the reviewer interface is very complicated. So you know, right, you write a book, then there are reviewers who tells, okay, this is wrong, this is wrong. So that becomes your first review. Then it comes back to the user. Then the user says, corrects all the comments given by the reviewer. Then it again goes for the second review. Now this process is quite complicated in the current system. So our focus here is how can we simplify the process which is already there. And if we can generate reports for each review, so the external reviewer or the admins can see, okay, what is the progress of a particular review. Now the earlier ones which I showed you are the already existing interfaces which needs to be enhanced. The third one is you need to create a user dashboard. Now currently what is happening, I am a user, I create many books, right, TBC books. After I get good amount of knowledge in it, I say that I'll also review books which other people have now created. So you become a reviewer. Now you become a user as well as a reviewer. So your roles, you are now at two roles, right? So these all activities, then your payment, you get paid for the TBC project. So all these activities should be mentioned in the user dashboard. This is a new interface which we'll like to add. The last thing would like is to create the entire theme in scilab.in. Now the FOSSI project used Drupal CMS. How many of you are aware of CMS? WordPress or Joomla, Drupal. So all these are CMS. So all the websites are being developed in Drupal. Okay. So we would like you to create a theme in Drupal. And the advantage of this will be, so we are having 14 other websites other than scilab.in. So the advantage of this theme will be that the theme developed by you will be used throughout all the other FOSSI websites. So the technologies, as you can see, is Drupal CMS, knowledge of PHP, MySQL, LaTeX because there are report generations and PDF generations, HTML, JS, CSS, basic web technology knowledge is required, and Git. Okay, any questions on this? Okay. So now second is enhancing FOSSI forums portal. Now, because we do promote open source software and hardware, so people do have questions, right, on installation, then how we can do. So there is a forum which we have created. So this has been developed in Django Python. So again, the main role of this is to enhance the existing interface, make it user friendly, and also how it can be more applicable towards user interface. So basically it's a question answer portal for installation and free open source software questions. So the existing system is just like the user comes, he posts the questions, then the experts answer. So this is the basic flow. Now what we want to enhance in this is that the rating system, how you know how Stack Overflow is, stackoverflow.com, right? So similar, but not that to that great extent do, but we are planning to reach towards that standard. So a rating system, then tags, like suppose I write or type a question, it should be able to fetch like, okay, these questions were already asked. So then duplicacy gets reduced. So such type of enhancements are required in this project. Secondly, is to create the admin interface. Currently everything is done by database and also a proper admin interface where the user, if there is some spam question or answer which needs to be deleted or edited or something like that, you should be able to do. So the technologies required here are Python, Django, HTML, JS, CSS, and Git. So the third one which I'm going to explain is about the interactive grading system. So I'm presenting this on behalf of Professor Sundar. So he would be the mentor for you. So the basic idea is that current grading system is manual, right? So I think that several autonomous institutions use letter grades for course grading. So the basic idea is you give some combination of formulas. Okay, so this is what he's explaining is that, so suppose I said ki 75% ke above will get A grade, then B grade, C grade, D grade. So this will anyways be done by using a formula. Now it should be an interactive tool where the teacher can actually change the parameters dynamically, okay, and it can automatically get updated according to those changes. So this is the rough idea. For any more details, you can directly contact Professor Suntha for the same. Okay, thank you.
So afternoon, all of you. My name is Rupak, and I would speak about two projects for this internship. So this first project is about improving SBHS remote triggered virtual lab server and website. So the title is very huge, and there are some jargons used, so I'll first clarify those jargons. First of all, SBHS is basically a device. It's a embedded system, it's a device, experimental setup. And SBHS stands for single board heater system. That's the name given to the setup. And remote triggered virtual lab is something that we'll see in the slides. Okay, so it's about virtual laboratory. How many of you know about the concept of virtual laboratory? Okay, so it's about extending laboratory experience to the students online. Okay, it's an independent project, virtual labs. And so a virtual laboratory, like it's an online facility. And now there are two categories in virtual laboratory. One is a simulation lab, where you do simulations. Okay, the other one is remote triggered lab. So simulation labs are the one in which everything happens on a browser. Like you can do some animations on it, like using Flash or HTML5. Or you know, JavaScript, whatever. And the other kind of lab is the remote triggered lab, wherein the device is actually sitting on the remote location, and the student is accessing that device over the internet from his home, hostel, wherever he is. Okay, so we are talking about that kind of virtual laboratory, remote triggered virtual laboratory. Okay, and we have a setup for this device, single board heater system. So in this RT lab, we are going to be accessing this device remotely over the internet. Okay. And there's the URL where you can just go and take a feel for it. So now coming to the work. So this entire system has been tested for like around 3 years now, more than 3 years. And over this period, we have found a couple of, not exactly bugs, but some problems, you know, inherently inside the server. We would want you to fix those problems. And we also want to add some new features to it. Okay, so the main problem that we have here that I'm talking about is basically about a no connection issue. Now, I mean, you have to figure out like why does this happen. It doesn't happen with all systems. Okay, so what I mean by all systems, so I have an array of this SBHS unit. So I have like around 32 such hardware devices, you know, connected online to the computer, to the server, and people access them remotely. So 32 devices. So this problem doesn't happen with all devices. A few couple of devices that happen randomly. So that is actually the problem statement here, the first problem statement. Second is, now there is an admin to it, right? And we need some admin features to be fixed. The first issue is like, MID is basically machine ID. So every board has its own machine ID. So there is some problem with the machine ID display, as in it takes up the wrong machine ID for some reason. So that has to be fixed. The second is, like I have 32 systems, right? And the public that is going to be accessing it is like millions, like, right? It's on the internet, so anybody can access it. So we have something called as a traffic control mechanism, called as a slot booking mechanism. It's similar to booking a movie ticket, right? What do you do when you go to a movie? You first buy a ticket. So you reserve your place, your seat, for like 3 hours, and then nobody takes the seat, right? The same thing happens here. You book a slot for an hour, and then nobody accesses that devices, but only you. Okay, so this booking page actually doesn't sort the booking properly by date time properly, so that is the issue. Third, we also have a web camera facility. So every device has a display on it, and we have a web camera attached to it, and it gives you a live feed on the server, on the web page. I'm talking about the admin interface, okay. So here, it doesn't auto refreshes the images, okay. So admin interface basically will show all the 32 or 40 devices connected, okay. It will show all the web cameras, feeds for all the devices. Okay, and then we need some test cases for the server, right? So suppose I want to add a new feature or if I want to redeploy it, I need some test cases for it to see in the development stage whether the modified version is working or not, or the new feature is working or not properly before I deploy it. Okay, now the other features that I talked about earlier were about fixing it. These are the new features which I want to add. So first is disabling the board. Like suppose some board is faulty. So I want to disable, you know, I want to make it offline so that nobody comes and, you know, sees it comes and, you know, tries to experiment and then he finds out that the board is not working. You have to avoid that. Okay, then a couple of some other things also, like notify reboot, because it's a hardware server. So if system reboots, in the middle, so when it reboots, it has to scan the devices again and make sure that these are all USB devices. So they are all properly listed, and each USB device is mapped to its user properly. Okay, so we need some intimation when the server reboots. Then timely, hardware health reporting, like is every hardware responding properly or not, timely reporting. Okay. Then also monitoring of the ongoing experiment. So admin, suppose a student is doing an experiment on board number one. Okay, and I'm a faculty, for example. I'm not a faculty, but suppose I'm a faculty. And I want to see how a student is doing it. Okay, so without I intervening in his experiment, I just want to be a monitor. Just want to see how the student is performing. So that, monitor interface has to be built. So the device, the right to the device is to the student. He would access his device, but the faculty would just, monitor it. That is one. Then a small feature, changing the MID. Now the second phase of this project is we want a master-slave architecture. Okay, so here what happens is the current software architecture for this RT lab is, one server, one device, one fleet of device and one server, that's it. If this server crashes, the entire lab is down. Okay, and then there is a limit. So I said USB devices, right? So there is a limit to how many USB devices you would connect to, one single computer. There's a limit to it, right? So one way to break that limit is to have multiple, servers. It's like one master and they have several slaves. So I can, plug out and plug in any number of slaves I want. It will multiply its capacity like anything. So that master-slave architecture has to be deployed. Okay. So this is the current server architecture. You should see this server computer. So what technologies I have used here is MySQL database server and Python Django for the main website server and Apache obviously for the web server. And I have like several devices connected to it. This is the client computer and everything happens over the internet. So this architecture has to be redesigned for a master-slave, topology. Okay, now there are some things to it. These we can actually skip. Okay, the next project is about optimization of Scilab instances on server. So you all know about Scilab. Anytime worked with Scilab as a part of a curriculum or something, right? One person I can see, okay. Scilab is basically a numerical computation tool. And so we use it extensively in most of our projects. Okay, and we are talking about optimizing its instances. Okay, so I'll come to it. Okay, so why Scilab? It's a free cross-platform software. It's compatible to MATLAB. MATLAB is, about MATLAB, right? You all know about MATLAB. So it's an open source equivalent to MATLAB. Scilab, okay. So the problems with the, so now as she talked about, TBC, yeah. So TBC, she talked about TBC earlier. That TBC would typically use Scilab, on the cloud, right? Yeah. So they would basically, run some Scilab code that the textbook has, over the cloud, okay? So the Scilab doesn't reside on the client's computer, it's on the cloud, and the server like pings to the cloud, does the computation, returns the answer and gives it back to the student, the user, okay? So now this process requires one Scilab instance to be there, right? So now the problem here is an instance of Scilab is very heavy, both memory as well as processor, okay? So it loads all default libraries. It doesn't just loads. So how Python works, Like it'll load only the libraries that you import, right? It doesn't blows up your entire system, it doesn't happen, right? But this like it's blows up completely. It's a big instance created and takes up a lot of memory and processor. Okay, so we need some workaround on it. So optimizing the instances. So what does it mean? I'll show you. So it's like there are multiple calls of Scilab code happening. Okay, so these are like users' codes and they're coming to the server. And as the number of server requests, user requests come, the number of Scilab instances increase and they tend to become resource hungry. Okay. So this is the proposed Scilab server. We are open to any solution, frankly speaking. If you have a better solution than what we are proposing, you are almost welcome for it. This is what we are talking about, that we are proposing for you to do. So the idea is basically we have to develop two things. One is a toolbox in Scilab that talks over the network, and one API, which, it's kind of a middleman. So it controls all the traffic that goes to the Scilab server, right? So if there are 100 requests, and I can source only 50 Scilab instances. So I will make the other 15 queue. I'll queue them up, I'll process the request properly, and I'll make sure that the instances are killed you know, whenever the job is done or cleared, whatever is optimized, and then, you know, queue up other things, and then they are all lined up. So you then, you know, continue this process as the instances become clear. Okay, so it's a pictorial representation. If you can, you know, get something out of it. These are the skills required, like Python, Java, C, C++. Okay.
Good afternoon. My name is Dipti, and I will be mentoring the project Xcosm Cloud. So before going to the project description and brief, I will just give a brief introduction about Scilab and the Xcos. So as Rupak already told you that Scilab is a free open source software, which is more equivalent to the MATLAB, which you use in your colleges. It is a powerful computing environment for scientific calculation and all that. So Xcos is a graphical package which is inside the Scilab, and it is used for creating diagrams, mostly the dynamic hydrobit modules system. And we have, like, in this Xcos we can design, save, then simulate and get the output of the modules. All Xcos blocks are grouped under categories, that is mathematical or either signal processing and so on. So they have many categories in that. So why Xcos on cloud? Why we came from a desktop application, which is a Xcos, to a cloud? Because we wanted to port all the core functionality of the Xcos desktop into a browser-based software, you can say. So advantage will be, one is that the client will not be installing any software. It's not required for installing on any software. Then the another advantage will be, like, a user has 24/7 access to that computing software. Then interested students or user can easily access it without any installation, and also on the machine which has an internet connection also. So this is the Xcos on cloud UI, and this is partially implemented by us. And as you can see on the left side, they are the blocks which I mentioned, which are categorized into different categories. So in this, we are just dragging the blocks to the canvas on the right side, and you can connect them through and then simulate. So once you click on simulate, this whole diagram is converted into a Xcos file that is sent to the server. Server executes and sends back the result to the browser, and that result is shown to the user. So for user, they don't have to install anything. They are just accessing the server and getting the result. So technologies which we have used in this is MX Graph. It is an open source JavaScript library, and it is basically used for creating the UI which you just saw, like last slide, and it generates the encoded XML, which is for use for Xcos file. Then we have a JavaScript. We have created like few of Scilab functions into JavaScript. So when we are executing any Xcos file, so the value should be same, which should be sent to the Scilab server on the server. So for that change of values from one format to another format, we have used JavaScript functions. So then we have XML, because we have to come up with an Xcos file whose XML content is similar, which goes to the desktop version. Then we have Python server and Python technology used, because we have a parser which actually works on SCI level. That is, it converts the blocks SCI file, which are in desktop application, to a JavaScript file, which is similar. Then even we have another, that is the computing technologies which we are using for reading such files and even getting the result from the server is based on Python. Then we have used HiChart, that is for dynamic display of the graph, and Scilab is there to run the simulation at the server side, and few more changes will be done on the Scilab side. So we want you people to implement, like, some enhanced feature in the existing system. One is dynamic graph for the scopes. Scopes are one of the categories of Xcos blocks, and they have graphs in that. So we would like to have a mechanism where the data from the Xcos is written into a file, and that is read by the HiChart, and a graph is generated for the user. then even there are few parameters for each block, that is get and set. We would like to complete such parameters, get and set, for almost 200 blocks are there for XCOS. So next is implementing display block functionality. Actually, it's just block. There is a block named display who gets the result from the server and it display within that same block. So it's a text change, you can say, within the block itself. Then another is working on the different format of the result. Sometime XCOS simulation sends text as a result. Sometime a image is written as a result. So we want all other different format to be supported. Then there is another task, that is two-way interaction between the server and the client. In this, there is a block named TK scale. If I change the value of the TK scale, the graph inputs changes. It's an input block. So we want the two-way communication to be implemented in this. Another is like modification of block code, that is on Scilab desktop part. The Scilab which is running on the server needs some changes to be done, so that the result will be written in a text file and that can be easily readed by the website or the client side. The skill which we require is Python, generally for the server computation and even for reading of high chart value and all. Then JavaScript, first for the blocks and second for creating the Scilab codes which will be used for changing the values from one format to other. Then XML for creating the XCOS files, which is compatible with the desktop version. Then is C, C++, because we want to change and modify some of the files of the Scilab desktop version. And last is Git, which is not mentioned over here, but we will want a person to like know a little bit of Git also. So that's it from my side.
Good afternoon. I'd be mentoring this project, developing a GUI for Open Modelica. Now, what is Open Modelica? So Open Modelica is an open source simulation environment. It is just like MATLAB, but it is very easy to code. I mean, you don't have to call any functions. You can straight away dump down your equations, and it solves them simultaneously. So it follows an equation-oriented approach. So as we learn from this, Open Modelica has very good steady state as well as dynamic solvers. So as such, it is very good for solving chemical engineering simulations. The only problem with Open Modelica is it doesn't have a good GUI that is capable of solving or executing chemical engineering simulations. So therefore, we need a good GUI. Now, this is the whole picture of the project. So here is Open Modelica sitting over there. We have to develop this Python GUI that can connect with Open Modelica, dump all those equations to Open Modelica, let Open Modelica solve those equations, and then the results will be thrown to the GUI. So it is basically a layer over Open Modelica. And then we'll have a good simulator that is capable of doing everything. So to carry out this, this is our usual approach. So already we have written unit operations and libraries for chemical engineering in Open Modelica. They have already been written. Now we need a Python GUI. So why Python now? Because Open Modelica forum already has an interface named as OMPython, which connects Open Modelica and Python. So it is good that we code it in Python. And so what this GUI will do basically is it will generate a .mo file. The .mo file is an extension for Open Modelica files. So as soon as the user drag unit operations or it connects all those files, MO file will be generated. Suppose a user drags a unit operation. So at the back end, a file will be created which says import this module. So basically it is replicating the work what a user does on the GUI. So at the end, it will generate a .mo file. It will send this .mo file to Open Modelica for simulation and collect the results and throw back the results to the GUI. So the objective is a complete desktop GUI with all the functionalities required for chemical process simulators, linking the GUI with Open Modelica using OMPython that I already discussed. The another thing is adding plotting functionalities. Now Open Modelica lacks plotting functionalities. You can only plot variables with respect to time. Basically, Open Modelica was developed just for dynamic simulations. Now they have gone for steady state as well. So basically, the only plotting functionality available in Modelica presently is with respect to time. So we have to add plotting functionalities. So we'll use some Python module for that. Okay, now this whole GUI that is developed in Python, so we are using a module named Kiwi. Has anyone used Kiwi till now? That is the most recent GUI module that Python has launched. It is still in development for about 5 to 6 years. And we have chose Python because it is a very advanced UI. I mean, so you just need to code only once, and that code is available to all platforms. You develop a GUI for a normal code for a GUI that is available in iOS, in Android, and all such platforms, all desktop platforms and all mobile platforms as well. So that is why we chose Kiwi to develop this, and it has great advanced functionalities that you will learn later probably. So the learning outcomes from this project would be hands-on experience on advanced GUI development in Python, an idea on interfacing Python with other programs. So in this project, we are integrating Python with OpenModelica, but you will get a general overview how to integrate Python or how to use Python to communicate with other softwares. And as a, so there's always a byproduct in everything. So this is a bio-learning in this project. So as such, you will be working on Kiwi. So you'll be very familiar with mobile app. I mean, you can develop all those mobile apps in Python by using Python for Android. That is a library that Android has developed. So you can code it in Python and develop apps as well. Yeah. So I'm handing over to Manas now. Thanks.
Hello, this is Manas, and I'll be mentoring this project. So I don't think anybody needs an introduction on IoT, because this is a multi-billion dollar industry and everybody is into IoT. You can name any company, IBM, Microsoft, any big companies into this domain. So, but before you can say the generic in the sense, the platform you will be developing should support heterogeneous devices and heterogeneous protocols. By heterogeneous devices, that means it should support the number of microcontroller families, or might be some other new controllers that will be coming. And then comes heterogeneous protocols. The IoT has some standard protocols. I can say MQTT and COEP, XMAP, and all those things. So the platform should support all these protocols. So this will be the algo for your implementation. So let me go through it. So you can see first this device. In the device, there will be all your sensors. Sensors in the sense it can be, let's say in generic sense, temperature, humidity, or it can be anything. So from the sensors, you have to take the data to the next level. That there comes the gateway. And the communication should be bidirectional. You can take the data from the sensors to the gateways, and also you can command something, like let's say I have to switch off the AC or whatever it is there. So the commands can be from the other side also. So the communication should be bidirectional. And then once your data comes from nodes to gateways, then it should be real-time streaming to the user application. So up to the gateway part, everything will be on hardware. Like it can be on the Arduino board or ESP8266, or then the aggregation gateway part, there comes Raspberry Pi. The gateway, in common sense, you can say it's a kind of a server. Then once your data comes to the user, it should be real time. Then the data should get stored in a structured manner. Why you need the data in a structural manner? The data you are getting from the sensor, it contains a lot many noise. Means sometimes it has some useful information, and sometimes it had some garbage values. So you have to filter out those garbage values so that the user get what he wants. So the data should be in a structured manner. Then your logic and analysis will be on the event processing part. Then what does it mean by logic and analysis? Let's say you have a temperature data inside a room. And let's say I have a set point, like it's a 25 degree. If the temperature data crosses 25 degree, my AC should be automatically switched on. So those logic and analysis part comes on the event processing part. Then the last part is user experience. User experience, it is like a front end of a application. Like you are giving a user a nice GUI having, yes, you can click this button, you can see all those data and have some nice plots and all those things. So this will be your basic algo. Means there might be some changes on the upper level. It depends on whatever you're going to implement. So let's describe it in a more fill. Yeah, you can see. On the device part, you will be having n number of sensors. It should be whatever you will be giving to the user the number of sensors or nodes he can be, he can add n number of sensors. It can be any number. And on one node, sensors might be in 1, 2, or it can be anything. Then comes your gateway part. The gateway part might be on RPI, BeagleBone, or anything. So up to that part, the hardware part is finished. Then comes your cloud. On the cloud part, you have your ingestion, that means your real-time streaming of data, storage in a structured manner, and analysis of your data. Yeah, so that is the overview of the implementation. And mostly, I'll be looking for this proficiency. Arduino Embedded C, JavaScript, database, and a bit of web development. That's it. Thank you.